Today, we are going to hear from our friend Dennis Edwards about tourism in Raleigh in the age of COVID and what's going on with the convention center. And I'm very much looking forward to hearing about that. We also have a lot of announcements, an awful lot of activity going on with Rotary as always. And we're going to try to do our best to keep you up to date on all of it. So without further delay, I'm going to turn this program over to Richard Watkins for the invocation and the pledge.
Thank you very much, Eric. So today's invocation comes straight from Rotary International, and it's called the Invocation of Relief. When we've been encircled by trauma, when we've been overwhelmed with grief, when we've seen the crush of horror, when we felt the villain's teeth, when we feared so long for safety, when we've doubted our beliefs, when we've been through so much turmoil, let us be the relief. Let us clasp our hands together. Let us look at what's beneath. Let us work to make society where kind respect is chief. And that is from Sean Bird of the Shuap Rotary in British Columbia, Canada. Charles, hopefully I said that correctly. If you now join me now for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the Republic for which it stands,
one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, beautiful, for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties, above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood, from sea to shining sea.
Thank you very, very much. Before I pass it back to you, President Eric, we started something in January at the beginning of the year, something that we call Meet a Rotarian. I and James LaMontia were the first two to go, and today I have the honor and privilege to introduce to you today's participant in Meet a Rotarian, are none other than Harrison Turner. Harrison?
Hello, fellow Rotarians. For those who I have not met in person or just don't know me, my name is Harrison. I am a commercial banker for North State Bank here in Raleigh. My office is downtown off of Fayetteville Street, so it's an easy walk when we were meeting over at the Wells Fargo building. But hopefully one day we'll get back to that soon this year. So just a little bit about myself. I'm originally from a huge city called Goldsboro, North Carolina, about 45 minutes east from here. It actually very interesting. About a year ago, I heard this. So the Triangle has been ranked like the top area in the United States for the most people with a master's and doctorate degrees per capita. Well, Goldsboro was also on a list. It has the most restaurants per capita in the state of North Carolina. I was raised Southern Baptist, so that kind of follows with the meet, greet, and eat. They follow suit with that. So anyways, but born and raised in Goldsboro. After graduating, I went to Liberty University up in Lynchburg, Virginia. Went to school originally to be a pastor. So I thought I was going to be, you know, in youth ministry or in a, you know, a lead pastor role. But every time I get in front of people to talk, even if it's virtually Zoom, I realize and reminded of why I was not called to be a pastor, because public speaking is one of my, you know, it's one of those things that gives me little jitters. So anyways, so went to school to be a pastor originally, but then my aunt worked at the bank and she said, hey, you should be a part-time teller. So I was a part-time teller in college and just kind of followed suit and fell in love with banking and have been in ever since. But still very active with our church. My wife and I, we've been here in the Triangle since 2010. She went to Meredith we go to Vintage Church in downtown. So we're very active there. I'm one of the deacons of the church. And yeah, we love this community. We love Raleigh. I find myself very blessed to be part of the Rotary of Raleigh. I mean, one, it's the oldest Rotary in Raleigh. And just the when I joined Rotary is actually, I was introduced to Rotary from my portfolio manager here at the bank. He said, hey, are you a Rotarian? And I said, no, I've never been to a Rotary meeting. And he literally found out what the next Rotary meeting was for Raleigh. And he says, all right, I'm taking you as a guest. And he's in the Rotary in Chapel Hill. So, but yeah, it's just amazing to see you walk into a room of people you don't know and everybody's extremely welcoming, extremely friendly. You become family very fast. And just the service above self. I mean, it's one of the things to be part of a group that has mantras or things that we live by, but Rotary is one of those few and far in betweens that you actually see people living what they stand and they say. So truly, truly honored to be part of this group. My wife and I, we have a 10-month-old at home. So yes, this past weekend we were at the park. It was her first time. Her name's Atlee. It was her first time being able to go to a park and really just kind of get in the grass and walk around. It's fantastic. I'm looking forward to spring getting here so we can have more days like that. But if there's any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer anything. But yeah, I'm very happy to be part of this group. The current New Generations chair for our Rotary group, and we'll be moving into the chair for membership. It's coming up here, I believe. So yeah, looking forward to serving each and every one of you well.
And that is Harrison Turner. Thank you so much. And speaking of family, I would be remiss to say that when everything gets better, I know my wife and I owe your family some dinner over our house when things get better. So that reminded me of that. So when things get better, expect an invitation. President Eric, back to you. I think we might have some guests with us.
Great. Thank you so much, Richard. Thanks for that lovely invocation. Sevelin, thanks as always for entertaining us with America the Beautiful. And Harrison, thank you for sharing. It has been a real pleasure having Harrison and the leadership here with the Rotary Club. If there's anybody that is always willing to jump in and help out with whatever is going on with a smile and with a creative spirit, Harrison is it. It's really, we're very fortunate. Although we're unfortunate to have Christy leaving as a membership chair, Harrison is going to do a great job with that next year. And we are just very happy that someone that sort of embodies the Rotary spirit, before he was a member of the Rotary Club, is with us in that regard. So thank you, Harrison. At this point, please let me know if there is anybody who is a guest today. Please raise your hand now, and this is your opportunity to introduce yourself. All right. Hearing none, we'll move on. The cart bucket is now open. So if you have a dollar to donate, please send a chat and we will note that, or you can send an email to Linda. Linda is out of town in Key West right now, but we will get that and we will be sure and bill you. We need to keep up the funding for the dementia research. Further announcements, we have some great upcoming programs. Next week, we're going to be hearing from Charisse Potts with Interact. And then the following week is Melania Chernoff, who's the corporate citizen director of Red Hat. So, you know, the great programs keep coming back to join us for the upcoming meetings, and we'll look forward to seeing you all there. All right, at this point, we have an announcement from Mary Moss about a special program that took place this weekend. Mary? All right, we'll
talk about it.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, I got it. I was muted. I forget that it's automatic. I'm pleased to be able to bring you up to date on another DEI program, diversity, equity, and inclusion program that I attended last week. And also another meeting I went to, there have been two for this weekend. The first was put on by a group in Florida, by the district. Hold on, I'll tell you the exact district. It was District 6960, where Daryl Keyes is the governor, and also Cindy Dora, who is the chair of Infinite Possibilities at the national level. And Stephanie Urchick was talking about, she was the Rotary International director who introduced Friday's discussion on embracing our differences. And they had two speakers there, Barry Rassen, who is the former Rotary International president and world leader, and then Brian Roosh, who is from the San Francisco Bay Area. And I won't go through all of what we talked about. It would take too long. But my first point here is to let you know that there are multiple opportunities out there. In fact, Harrison, I know you were trying to get on that, and I don't know if you actually were able to go to it. Jim Dorsett, I know, was also trying to do it, and maybe there were others in the firm and the in this club who were doing that. But it really is, Rotary is trying. You know, this is a learning life lessons as you are trying to build program at the same time. It's all intertwined, but I will say this is the first program I've been to outside of our district. And to have Barry Rassen speak, Brian Roosh, and others, there were over 1,000 people on this call all over the world. And it was really interesting that it was put together by that district in Florida. And I don't know exactly how they got it together, but there were multiple slides. I'll be happy to email you the presentation on it. Basically, they broke down again, what does diversity mean? And then I spent Saturday working within our own district at a special meeting. We're getting ready to write a report with recommendations for our own district. And people have said that our district is actually way ahead of the game. One person has even been quoted as saying that our district is ahead of Rotary International in making an effort to put together a plan on how to educate our and involve and embrace our district's differences, as well as put up a framework for how to have conversations. And I welcome your ideas at the district level. I am one of two reps. Dana Johnson, of course, is helping on this too. So reach out to either of us if you have ideas on what you'd like to be included in the report. I will be on the writing team for that report. So stay tuned. It'll happen before the end of the year. That's all I had to say.
All right. Thank you so much, Mary, for your efforts in this. You know, I think people like to think that making sure that any organization is welcoming from people from all races and backgrounds is just something that ought to happen automatically, but that's not the way it works. It does take intentional effort, and we appreciate the work that you're doing towards that, and we all need to kind of keep in mind that, that making our club welcoming for all in a place where you know, a diverse array of people fit in and are welcome is something that is we all need to strive for. All right, next we have a report from Mark Hackett. Mark?
Good afternoon, Eric and fellow Rotarians. So the announcement I want to make today is again about Southeast Raleigh, well, the Rotary Club of Southeast Raleigh, which as you know is a satellite club of ours. Last Thursday, February 25th, they actually celebrated their 1 year anniversary, which is fantastic. I've said this before, but before COVID hit, the pandemic, we only met once in person, and the rest of these have been via Zoom, but they've been able to maintain. They still have about 16 members, which has been pretty consistent. They've had people come and go, but they've stayed right about 16 members. And we're hoping over the next year, less than a year actually, that we're able to get that up to 20, because to split them off as a full-fledged Rotary Club, they need to have 20 members. So if you know someone who lives and or works in Southeast Raleigh that may be interested or may not be interested, you can twist a few arms, then let them or let me know. They meet each Tuesday at 6:30. Again, it's a great club. So it'd be beneficial for anyone that you may know to join them. I do want to take a quick second to thank President Eric, Jim Dorsett, Valerie, Linda, Elsa, Dana, and others who have helped not only to establish that club, but also to keep them going over the last year. I think it's been a pretty successful story. I think that's it. Thanks, Eric.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you as always for everything that you are doing for our club and to help us support the Southeast Raleigh Club. All right, next we're going to hear from Sarah Reeves about the wonderful event that took place this weekend. Sarah?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Thanks to all those who came on Saturday to Dix Park. We had a walking tour at Plaza and Play led by Grayson Mond from the city staff, and she's heading up that project for the city. And we combined with our club and the Southeast Club and one local garden club. So we had a good turnout, and even Frank McNally was there, and he said, next time we do this at Dix Park, when we're through COVID, we could have barbecue sandwiches from the pit. So we'll do this again with another tour, maybe at the chapel or whichever project at Dix, and invite everyone and do barbecue sandwiches. But thank you so much to all those who came. And if people have questions about Dix, they can let me know. But most of all, your input to Grayson or through the Dix website is always appreciated. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Sarah. That was a really, really nice event. I think there are somewhere around 20 people there, and the weather held up. So I got to see Braxton Wilson in his fancy cycling gear. I had some nice conversations with Suri and Dr. Bilbro about their long history together. If you ever get a chance to touch base with them, you know, maybe at an in-person meeting one of these days. Be sure and ask them about that. And we were serenaded by a hound dog. So another plus, but that was a great event, and really looking forward to seeing what happens with Dix Park over the next couple of years. Next, we have a report on membership from Christy Santacana.
Good afternoon, everyone. Just a quick report today to update y'all on a virtual social that we had last week on Thursday evening. We just had a small group of us, but it was really great as always. I got to catch up on what everyone has been up to, hear from a few of the ones fortunate enough to have received their vaccines already and kind of get their experience on that. So that was really interesting for me to hear about. But we hopefully, since we are rolling into spring in the next few months, hopefully we'll have some warm enough weather that we could possibly hold something in person outdoors, you know, with taking necessary precautions for those who are comfortable. So we'll keep you posted on that as, you know, springtime weather rolls in. But otherwise, that is actually it for today.
All right. Thank you so much, Christy. Thanks for all you do. And we'll be looking forward to hearing more about those opportunities coming up. Next, we're going to hear from Gina Yacone. She's got a lot to talk with us about with regard to service.
Hello, everyone. If you guys were not on the call last Monday, just wanted to do another shout out. We were nominated by a City of Raleigh employee, Michael DeGrosa, for our contributions and service to one of the parks in Southeast Raleigh. So as you guys may be aware, Eric was working with the Southeast Raleigh Club to put together a grant, a district grant, which we got money for around $5,000. And as such, we used that money to beautify a park, as well as we're getting a bench put in. So because of that service that we did to the community, Michael DeGrosa put us up for this award and we won. So Eric and Mia Davis from the Southeast Raleigh Club will be getting the award. But if you guys, just if you didn't hear that last week, wanted to make sure that we did something outstanding during a pandemic and won a service award. So thank you for all that participated, as well as Eric and Southeast Raleigh for donating their time and resources to get us recognition. All right, next slide. Okay, so this one is just something that I would love to draw your attention to. It March 17th is Amniotic Fluid Awareness Day. And so David Forrest has a client who is a survivor of this and really is trying to draw attention. And it is part fundraiser. So not only is it something where you can go and donate blood, but everybody that donates blood, the Blood Connection is going to give $20 to the AFE Foundation. And their goal is to raise $2,400 through people donating blood. So there are location or there are signup sheets. You just have to go to the Blood Connection and the locations I have listed here. There's one in Wake Forest, there's one in Six Forks, one in Durham, and one in Cary. I especially like the one in Cary because it's at a brewing company. So most likely I'll go to that one. So March 27th though, save the date. It is for a good cause. I love this because not only will you be donating blood, which is always really good for the community at large, there is a blood shortage. You also get a free antibody test regarding COVID and you will be helping out this foundation. So please just kind of maybe save the date and think about donating blood on this date for this great cause. All right, next slide. Okay, as you are aware, it's coming up around the corner. Hopefully you've saved the dates. So we got Friday, April 16th will be our opening ceremonies for the Day of Service weekend. Saturday, April 17th, we'll be having volunteer events throughout the day. And Saturday night, we are going to have a wine and Girl Scout cookie pairings. So that'll be our virtual fundraiser. So there is a lot of stuff that's going on behind the scenes for this. As of right now, I've actually been on 5 calls today because I gave the district a deadline of March 1st to provide me with information about different service projects that the district's doing, including some of the projects that we're doing. So my phone has been busy. I'm hoping to have all this information on kind of the who, what, when, where, why to present to you by next Monday's meeting. So just so you guys know, Friday, April 16th, virtual opening ceremonies. Saturday, we'll either have in-person events and or a donation drop-off for you to attend, as well as a great fundraiser put on by our fundraising chair, Alex. So things to look forward to and really, really excited about this. Next slide. So these are our possible community partners. You guys, we're in the middle of a pandemic, so it is hard to get in-person volunteer events set up. So some of this list is always changing. We had two groups that decided that they cannot participate because of COVID restrictions, and that is totally acceptable. But we do have a pretty robust list right here of groups that will be participating. So there's not going to be tons of opportunities for in-person events. It might be like four people here or four people there. So just keep that in mind. All of them will add up to be a good number of people. We want you guys to respect, of course, COVID guidelines. And if you can't participate in an in-person event because maybe you don't feel comfortable yet with COVID, or maybe you haven't gotten that second vaccine or even your first vaccine, that is okay. We will have a fundraising link if you want to maybe donate instead of maybe donate money instead of donate your time, as well as we have that amazing fundraiser. So our goal is to raise at least $7,000 for seven nonprofit organizations. So keep that in mind. There will be more information ahead. I think that's it for me, and I hope everybody has a wonderful Monday.
Thank you so much, Dina. Gina, you are doing great work on this, and just be careful. You're, working long hours, and then you're going to go give blood and drink a beer afterwards. If you need somebody to be your Uber, give me a call.
Thanks, Aaron. I may take you up on that offer. Actually, though, who just won a Tesla? Didn't somebody just win something? Somebody just won a car. A Porsche, wasn't it a Porsche? It was Supreme Court Justice. So yes, I may make her husband drive me around that day.
Sounds good. All right. Got some birthdays to celebrate. Mark Blake on the 28th. Happy birthday to Mark, slightly belated. Duncan Jennings is coming up in a couple of days. Happy birthday, Duncan. Suri Roberts has a birthday coming up. Suri. Happy birthday, and Brad Creeley on the 6th. So I hope everybody enjoys their special day. And with that, we will move on to our speaker. David Forrest is going to be introducing Dennis Edwards to speak to us.
I'm gonna step in and do the introduction.
Okay.
So, if you didn't get a chance to check this out, this is just really, really interesting. Dennis Edwards, or Denny, is the president and CEO of the Greater Raleigh Convention and Visitors Bureau, whose role it is to sell, market Greater Raleigh as a tourist and meetings destination. The GRCVB has a staff of 32 people and an annual budget of $8.2 million. He has served in this capacity since April 2007. Prior to joining the GRCVB, Denny served as a senior vice president for the Greater Fort Lauderdale Convention and Visitors Bureau for 10 years. A 38-year CVB veteran, Denny was also the director of sales for the Greater Houston CVB, and prior to that, served as the director of sales for the Palm Springs Desert Resort CVB. He currently serves on the board of directors for the North Carolina Travel and Tourism Coalition, North Carolina Travel and Tourism Board, East Carolina Hospitality Management Advisory Board, Wake County Economic Development, and the Regional Transportation Alliance. Denny served on the board of directors for the American Society of Association Executives, Professional Convention Management Association, and Destinations International, where he also served on the foundation board. He was an apex commissioner for the Convention Industry Council and also served on the International Association of Exhibitors and Events Exhibitor Advisory Council, and is a past president of the Florida chapter. Then he received a Business Leader 2009 Triangle Mover and Shaker Award. And Iowa native, Denny is a graduate from the University of Northern Iowa, where he received a Bachelor's of Arts with a major in public relations and minor in business marketing. He and his wife, Cindy, have two boys, Bryce and Drake, and Owen, the grandchild, the best grandchild ever. Ladies and gentlemen, Dennis Edwards.
Well, thanks for the introduction. Can you give me a thumbs up if you can hear me and see my slide? So, great. Well, it's a pleasure being here. I'm going to spend just a few minutes talking about what the Convention and Visitors Bureau is, our role, and then obviously you all probably want to hear a little bit about COVID and the impacts on tourism. Our role is to sell and market all of Wake County for visitation. That can be in leisure, conventions and meetings, sports, sporting events, a number of things. Our marketing department works very hard on ensuring that our website, which is visitraleigh.com, is updated literally on a daily basis with all the current information that visitors and, quite frankly, residents may be interested in terms of what's happening in Wake County. We also produce a hard copy of an official visitor's guide, which is available to anyone. We also work very hard on social media, promoting all Wake County and encouraging visitation to this destination. So encourage you to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, all the other good social media platforms that are out there. We also have an email campaign that goes out on a monthly basis. We've got a database of over about 76,000 people that local people and people throughout the country that want updated information on this area. So we produce a monthly newsletter as well. We also have a PR department that works extremely hard on pitching story ideas to various publications literally around the world to get them to write stories about this area. A lot of times travel writers will want to come into the destination, see the facilities, meet the people firsthand. So we take care of all those arrangements as well. We also have a convention sales department. Their job is to promote meetings of anywhere from 10 people up to 10,000. Our job is to also sell the Raleigh Convention Center. So we obviously work very closely with a number of organizations and associations around the country to hopefully entice them to have their meetings here in the Raleigh market. We also have a services department. Once a meeting or a sporting event has selected the Raleigh area, they act as a liaison between the county and their organization. So if they need things such as special signage, road closures, photographers, additional assistance, we act as that liaison for the meeting planner. We also have a sports marketing department. Their job is to focus a lot on sports amateur and collegiate sporting events. So this department is the department that goes out and bids on all the NCAA championship events, to soccer tournaments, baseball tournaments, you name it. They're out there pitching this area for a number of sporting events around the county. From a results standpoint, 2019 was a great year for us. We had a record 17.9 million visitors that came into the destination, which was our best year ever. Those visitors spent $2.9 billion in Wake County and also generated $284 million in state and local tax revenue. I want to point out the hotel and food and beverage tax. Any individual that meets in our county will pay a 6% hotel tax and a 1% prepared food and beverage tax anytime they go to a restaurant or a bar. Those taxes are considered what many referred to as the interlocal fund. That fund then is really what helps us build quality of place in the area. Those funds last year or in 2020 or 2019 generated over $51 million. And the majority of those funds are allocated as a decision between the Wake County Commissioners and the Raleigh City Council to determine how those funds are spent. Some of the projects, not only are these projects to help us entice visitation to the county, but it also gives us as residents some great amenities to enjoy throughout the year. Those funds have built things like the PNC Arena, the Raleigh Convention Center, to the Performing Arts Center, Ting Park down in Holly Springs, Wake Med Soccer Park, Five County Stadium, USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, Marvel's Kids Museum, expansions at the Museum of Art, and honestly, the Natural Science Museum were all spent by interlocal funds. So again, it doesn't take our taxpayer money to build these facilities. It's all being paid for by visitors that come into the county. On a job market, we had prior to COVID over 67,000 full-time and part-time employees, over 28,000 full-time employees in the hospitality sector. We also worked very hard on advocating for our tourism industry, have been spending a lot of time recently advocating certainly for communication with the state, local, and feds, honestly, for aid and relief for our hospitality sector, which is severely impacted. Also advocating on, health and safety protocols right now for our industry. So we're the ones out there as the voice for the tourism industry and honestly for our visitors. We also spend a lot of time talking about enhancements for the visitor experience. We look at everything from what is that experience once a visitor lands into RDU, when they take a taxi, when they walk into one of our retail establishments or hotels or restaurants. We want to make sure that they have a consistent wow experience when they're here. So we spend a lot of time on training and everything from ADA compliance to customer service to ensure that all of our businesses are prepared to handle visitors in a hospitable way, and one that I think all of us here in the Raleigh market certainly expect. We're also involved a lot with destination development. I know you all talked a little bit about Dick's Park. I serve on the Conservancy as well. Again, to really talk about what enhancements are taking place at Dick's Park that is going to have an impact on visitation, not only from a residential standpoint, but for those people that might be coming into the market to visit the park, what's going to be that wow experience that people are going to want to talk about and say, you know, anytime you visit Raleigh, you have to go to Dick's Park. We're also involved a lot with discussions with the enhancements at the arena, convention center expansion, new hotel development. Honestly, anything that impacts a visitor, we've got a seat at the table, even transportation needs. We serve on the Regional Transportation Alliance as well. To really give our perspective from a visitor standpoint, how is that going to really impact and increase visitation? Now a little bit about COVID. Obviously it's impacted many of us on this call, but leisure and hospitality was, we felt it the quickest. Our sector was definitely the hardest hit and will likely be the last to recover. COVID has definitely had a major impact on our industry for sure. As an example, hotel occupancy in 2020, we ran at 44.2%. That was down 40%. We typically run around 74% occupancy. So you can see how it really impacted the hotels. Average daily rate was also impacted, down over 20%. Therefore, our prepared food and beverage tax collections, again, were down $7.4 million or 23% in 20. And our hotel revenues were down even greater percentage, 52.8%. Again, that's going to have an impact on our ability to do future projects, at least in the short term, and certainly having an impact even on our budget, because we receive a small percentage of that interlocal fund. So our budget has been cut by about 60% from what we can do here at the Convention and Visitors Bureau. Also, just since COVID hit, we have lost over 327 meetings and sporting events for an economic impact of over $176 million. We literally closed the convention center in March of 20 and had our first event last weekend. So almost a year since we've had anything in the Raleigh Convention Center. So definitely has had a major impact on our ability to bring in any kind of outside visitation. Y'all know that the RDU has certainly been impacted as well. At the worst of COVID, their capacity was down 95%. It's improved a little bit. They're still off about 66% from where they were. At the height of our economy back in 19, we had direct service to 57 destinations. We're now down to 36. So we have a ways to go to really rebound from an RDU standpoint as well. Talk a little bit about jobs. Our segment was severely impacted from a job standpoint. We had 56% of total jobs lost in North Carolina were in the leisure and hospitality sector. Just in Wake County alone, 66% of our employees in the leisure and hospitality sector were furloughed or laid off permanently. So definitely has had a major impact on our industry. I'll give you an example. The Raleigh Marriott downtown typically has 197 full-time employees. They're down to 22. And that's pretty common among all of our hotels on a countywide level. Talk a little bit about recovery. We really, for about the first 7 months, we're really in a response mode, working very closely with our hospitality partners, local and state officials to ensure that we were ready to open when the time came. And then back in August, we received about $1.2 million of the CARES Act fund to help us implement a recovery marketing program. We implemented a campaign called Wish You Were Here. This was really targeted to all North Carolina residents, our local residents, as well as a little few people in Virginia and surrounding states, but it was really geared more to talk about what was currently open, what is currently open, and the health and safety protocols that many of our restaurants and hotels and attractions are following. We also worked very closely with the North Carolina Restaurant and Lodging Association, along with Visit North Carolina, on creating and executing a Count on Me and See program. This is a free training program for health and safety protocol for any business that has face-to-face interaction with customers. It's training for back of the house, front of the house, things that they need to do to ensure that their employees as well as their guests are safe when they have that face-to-face interaction. So again, that was a program that is ongoing and again helps reassure and build that consumer confidence that people can once again begin to travel. From a forecast standpoint, I will say RDU has improved some. The airlines are starting to feel a little bit bullish on this area. In the last 2 months, JetBlue Airlines has added 12 new destinations. Delta Airlines has added 4 new destinations. RDU is still considered a focus city for Delta Airlines. That is us, along with Austin, Nashville, and Boston, are 4 non-hub cities that they feel very confident about, and they want to start adding additional service very, very quickly. I do believe that international service, along with conversations I've had with Delta and American, they do believe in returning those international Paris and London flights this year. They were hoping actually for March. It looks like now it'll probably be late summer, early fall. Again, it really depends on how quickly those international cities and destinations open up to international travel. We believe that leisure market will return the quickest. There was a survey done just last week that indicated that 81% of the American public have trips planned in the next 6 months. If you think about your own individual travel arrangements, I'm sure many of you want to go see friends and relatives that you haven't seen in over a year. That's the market that's probably going to rebound very, very quickly. The weddings market even has started to pick up. So on the leisure side, there's a lot of pent-up demand. People just want to get out even for a short weekend. We are starting to have some youth and amateur sporting events during COVID and starting to see an increase now. Some of you may know we had just about a month ago, 3 weekends of pretty good size soccer tournaments throughout the county. We had last weekend our first volleyball tournament in the convention center, about 150 teams. Again, all teams had to follow very strict health and safety protocols, including all of the participants had to wear masks when they were playing volleyball. So there was a lot of strict protocols with those tournaments. So we do think sporting events will likely return relatively quick to normal numbers. Business travel is still going to remain relatively slow, particularly until offices and organizations begin returning to their offices, business travel will remain slow. And then we're also facing the fact that we're not sure how quickly employers are going to want to put their employees on the road from a liability standpoint. So there's some issues really impacting business travel. Meetings and conventions, we're starting to see some meetings and conventions around 200 people. I think your larger conventions of 1,000 or so likely won't return until 2022. And then that wild card is events, festivals, and concerts. I know the state fair is really hoping to have a state fair this October. Live Nation, who books the majority of our concerts in most of our venues here in the county, they are booking concerts heavily in August and through the fall, actually all the way into November. Again, hoping that things will improve. And then sporting events, you all know the Canes and the NC State are starting to let spectators back at a very limited capacity, but that's a good sign. We are the ones that produce, our organization produces the Bluegrass Festival every year. We've had and continue to have very frequent conversations with IBMA to really determine what that IBMA Bluegrass Festival looks like this fall. We're looking at everything from a hybrid to maybe just having entertainment in Red Hat and no street festival to the entire street festival. So again, a lot of that is going to be dependent on how soon people get vaccines and how soon our governor and others feel confident that we can have mass gathering. So certainly the executive orders have had a major impact on our industry, and the sooner we can start lifting some of the mass gatherings, the better off we're gonna be, certainly from a tourism standpoint. So, and that's pretty much all the upcoming events. Is a lot of things in the unknown right now, but we are hosting Major League Baseball's first combine. Y'all may be familiar with the NFL combine, but we now, Major League Baseball has never had a combine. They're now going to have one here in Cary in June. That'll be an annual event. And we also have a few esports gaming activities that have booked at the Raleigh Convention Center. So we're hoping that we're gonna see more activity, probably not until June, July timeframe is hopefully the time where we're start seeing some more normal numbers from a visitation standpoint. So with that, that wraps up my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Denny. Really, really appreciate it. I will remind all of those in attendance to throw any questions that you have in the chat, and we will get to them. And so I just actually like to start us off before I get to a question from President Eric. And that question is in regards to the bump that you're expecting to see, you know, once things start reopening. Could you tell me a little bit about what people in your industry are predicting to be that bump due to built up anticipation from consumers wanting to get back out and go to events? Is there any idea of what you expect that bump will be once things kind of quote unquote get back to normal?
Yeah, I think the challenge is, Richard, I think part of the challenge is not only from a vaccine standpoint, but we also know that there's going to be a percentage of people that refuse to take the vaccine. So they're going to have some form, or we, our industry, is going to have to develop some form of rapid testing as well. So we envision there's going to be a period probably in the summer or the fall where people will have to show some kind of an app on their phone that will either indicate that they've been vaccinated or they have just recently been tested. We do believe that from a meetings and convention standpoint, even though meetings and conventions will be allowed to start meeting hopefully in the fall, attendance will still be severely impacted. So we may have the same number of conventions at the convention center, but attendance will probably be in half. Most of the meeting planners we've been in conversations with anticipate that they'll probably do some form of a hybrid meeting, meaning that some attendees will be in person. They'll still do virtual abilities as well, where people that can't travel, don't want to travel, will be able to participate in the program. There's still, 2021 is still a lot of unknowns. We really don't think we're going to start seeing more normal numbers until 22. And full recovery for our industry, we probably won't see the types of numbers that we've seen in 2019 until 2025. So we're probably another 5 years away, 4 to 5 years away from fully recovering, not only here in Wake County, but on a national level.
Wow. Thank you very much on that. Eric Stevens, President Eric, said, you know, he picked up lunch today earlier at Plaza Cafe, and the owner told him, my chat disappeared. So the owner told him that she and her employees had just gotten their first vaccination. Is your organization involved with helping tourism workers get their vaccinations?
We are involved with encouraging and working with DHSS or DHHS on finding out for sure when frontline employees, such as those in the hospitality sector, whether it's a restaurant, a hotel, qualify. They now fit into that third A category. So some of the frontline workers now can start receiving vaccinations. So we do our best on making sure communication information is accurate, and then sharing that information with all of our hospitality partners throughout the entire county.
Thank you very much. And it looks like I already asked David's question, or part of your response to my earlier question was an answer to his question. One of my questions is, you know, in your introduction, you explained that you worked in a wide variety of capacities regarding visitor bureaus. How does Raleigh's visitor bureaus compare to other visitor bureaus in response to COVID and kind of getting tourism and meetings back online? Is Raleigh doing a better job, or where do we rank as far as, you know, what you've seen before?
Of course, I think we're doing the best in the country. I think we are doing an incredible job. I think the county and the city, I have to give them a lot of praise to recognize the importance of tourism. And by giving us that $1.2 million in CARES Act money, to ensure that we continue to be out in the marketplace and promoting the area. Our message certainly changed a lot, but it was important for us to remain in the marketplace. Event organizers, meeting planners, although they might have paused this year's meetings, they're still looking at locations for, you know, 2024 and 25 and 26. So we're working in the future right now as well. So I think we've done a really good job in that area. I will say one of our challenges, though, and I don't want to talk politics, but one of our challenges is particularly hosting meetings and sporting events. We still have a lot of restrictions here in North Carolina. And in our surrounding states like Tennessee, South Carolina, Georgia, Texas, Florida, they're essentially wide open as long as they follow health and safety protocols. So we in fact, I'll give you an example. We just lost 3 basketball tournaments last week that were scheduled to meet at the Raleigh Convention Center for April that had to cancel and move to a different state because they're not allowed to have basketball tournaments in North Carolina. We're running into those kind of conversations literally on a daily basis because some states are opening up quicker than North Carolina. So that's really causing us some real challenges, particularly short term, and trying to maintain and hold anything that might be currently on the books.
Thank you for providing us a little bit of context of how North Carolina and Raleigh specifically fits in with the rest of the nation or specifically this region. And I just like to personally, so we do have a question that just popped in. I was about to close out. Do you have time to answer one more question?
Sure, you bet.
So Elser Silverman says, I see on TV a new WELL certification for restaurants regarding safety to eat indoors. Can you talk a little bit about that? Are you familiar with that? And what have, you know, businesses in the Raleigh area, what has been their experiences with that kind of wellness certificate?
Yeah, I mean, most of them are still following that Count on Me certification program. And that was really designed for employees as well as customers, but a lot of emphasis on employees, on ensuring that once people can start meeting indoors, that they have the proper health and safety protocols. Not only are the employees following the health and safety protocols, but are the restaurants set up or the bars set up properly? Do they have the right equipment? Are they sanitizing properly? All that information is included in that Count on Me and C program. And most of our restaurants and hotels have taken that certification program, and many of their employees have done the same.
Well, thank you so much for what you do for the state of North Carolina, what you do specifically for Raleigh. You know, we all really, really appreciate it. And we know these are difficult times, but, you know, with the work that you and your staff are doing, I think we'll be right on track as soon as possible. And we're looking forward to getting back together. And moreover, thank you for, you know, spending your afternoon with us here at the Rotary Club of Raleigh, North Carolina. We truly appreciate it. President Eric, back to you if you have any more comments.
Thank you so much, Richard, and thank you, Denny, for that very eye-opening presentation.
Thank you.
The thing you said that kind of really made me pause for a minute was when you talked about the Marriott and the change of employment there. Really kind of brings it all home, what kind of impact this pandemic has had, particularly on the hospitality and tourism industry. So thank you for all you were doing to advocate for that industry and to kind of help prepare everybody for you guys to be there for all of our benefit and for the benefit of the North Carolina economy, you know, as soon as we're able to get back to some semblance of normal. So thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And with that, Rotarians, we will close with the 4-way test of the things we think, say, and do. First, is it the truth? Second, is it fair or at all concerned? Third, will it build goodwill and better friendships? And fourth,
will it be beneficial to all concerned?
Thank you so much. We are adjourned.
Thanks. Have a good week.
Have a great week.